everybody, and welcome to the Meeting House, where we have conversation on religion and American life. I'm your host, Dr. Dwight A. Moody. Thank you for stopping by today. And while you're here, you're going to get a dose of the news. I have 5 news stories, as I do each week. And then I have a guest from Hartford, Connecticut. He published an article this past week on the growth of a certain segment of the Christian world, that is, the independent or non-denominational congregation. Dr. Scott Thumma, the professor of sociology of religion and director of the Hartford Institute for Religion Research. He'll be joining me virtually in just a few minutes. But in the studio today is one of my collaborators in the media world, Mr. Caleb Owolabi. Caleb, nice to see you today.
Thank you, Dwight. Thank you for having me.
Caleb has been my coach and my mentor, teaching me about lots of things related to the production of a show like this. You have a lot of experience in this.
Yes, I do. But, you know, it's good to see a show in this beautiful studio. I mean, this is really excellent. It's good to be in the Meeting House.
Thank you. I'm so glad you're here. We're going to talk a little bit later about how we met.
Absolutely.
And where we met and why we met. About 6 or 8 months ago.
That's exciting.
And where all that has led.
Absolutely.
But first, as always, we've got the news. One death to report today, noted Washington Post columnist, and before that, presidential speechwriter, Michael Gerson, died at the age of 58 from liver cancer. Gerson was born, educated, and then participated in the broader evangelical Christian culture, graduating from Wheaton College up in Chicago. He frequently brought his deep religious faith into his writing for the general public, including presidential speeches. From Mar-a-Lago, of course, former U.S. President Donald Trump formally announced his candidacy for another term as president, but this time his significant network of support from religious leaders appears to be very weak. Very few attended the event at his home estate in Florida, and even fewer responded to his announcement with strong endorsement. Noted endorser Robert Jeffress of Texas was noncommittal on the issue, as were the Reverend Paula White Cain of Florida, who was very prominent during his administration a few years ago, and the Reverend Mike Evans of Texas. And one group to keep your eye on, we're certainly going to do that here in the Meeting House, is Pentecostals, especially those in the Latino community. And now from Williamstown, Kentucky, up near my home, Ken Ham announced that his nonprofit religious organization, Answers in Genesis, has purchased a 205,000 square foot building and its campus to house his Answers Academy. It is the property that once housed the North American headquarters of Toyota in Northern Kentucky. They just paid $31.3 million for this property. The Answers Academy is a K-12 school. The new facility will allow it to accommodate up to 500 students. Answers in Genesis owns and operates the replica of Noah's Ark, a place that I've never been but want to go. And now they're planning to build a replica of the Tower of Babel. This is all a very interesting story to me. We're going to cover it later. And then from Charlotte, North Carolina, a nonprofit organization called Ministry Watch monitors the revenue income of Christian ministries. They just published their list of the top income religious nonprofits. I think you'll be surprised. Number one on the list, Grand Canyon University out in Arizona. Used to be a nonprofit, almost went under, shifted to a for-profit model, went into the distance learning business, and then shifted back to nonprofit. Last year or the year before, they took in $1.47 billion in income. Number two on the list, another school, Liberty University in Virginia. Number three on the list, Baylor University down in Texas at $1.25 billion. There's a list of another 20 or so that I could read off, but finally, I want to go to our last story in New York. This week, while we're here in the meeting house, more than 6,000 Jewish rabbis and their families and friends are gathered in New York for their annual convention, complete with workshops, the veneration of graves of their founders, the dedication of some handwritten Torah scrolls, and an annual group picture. They are part of a group called the Chabad Lubavitch Movement, which in turn represents the Hasidic wing of Orthodox Judaism. The Hasidim, as they're popularly known, emphasize the joyful, dancing part of Judaism. Even while they adhere to strict rules about dress, behavior, and doctrine. Well, that's the news from the meeting house. I want to take a break now and watch some of these Hasidic Jews dancing their religion. That's a video of the Hasidim in New York City dancing. I'm fascinated by this video. The things that I noticed were the fact that these were all men and boys, including very young boys. And of course, the hats they're wearing makes me want to do a whole program on the Hasidim. I think that would be very interesting. I'd like to do it on location somewhere, but I doubt that there are very many of those religious believers down here in Greenville, South Carolina. Thank you for joining us in the Meeting House this week. I'm your host, Dr. Dwight A. Moody. And one of the stories we did not cover is this news. Christians attending non-denominational churches or unaffiliated congregations, that is unaffiliated with a denomination, is now the largest portion of the Christian population in the United States. They now surpassed the Baptist, especially the Southern Baptist, and the United Methodist in adherence. They may be the single biggest and most consequential trend in American religion. Occasional Meeting House guest Ryan Burge has written about the nones, that is, people who have no religious preference, and now the nones, people who are involved in non-denominational gatherings. Today in the Meeting House, we have another scholar and author, Dr. Scott Thumma, professor of sociology of religion and director of the Hartford Institute for Religion Research. And I want to extend my welcome to Scott. Welcome to the Meeting House, your first visit.
Yeah, thank you, Dwight. It's great to be here.
It's, you know, we're down in South Carolina. I know you have roots in the South as well, both growing up and your education in Atlanta. But you're now up in the Northeast.
That's correct. Yeah,
that's right. Working for the Hartford Institute. Let me start by asking a question about the Hartford Institute.
Sure.
Tell me about it.
It's a research institute that focuses mostly on congregational and denominational life, kind of the organized aspects of religion. And we have been doing studies and research for about the last 40 years. Most of our material gets put on website at hartfordinstitute.org, but also we write books and do other kinds of research.
And you've just written, you just finished up a study on the religious landscape in America. I want you to explain first where this data comes from, this national survey that you all analyze.
Yes, what we did released last week is called the U.S. Religion Census, and it happens every 10 years. And essentially what we're trying to do, there was a whole group of people working through the Association of Statisticians of Religious Bodies, denominational organizations. We try to map all of the congregations in the country and then approximate how large each of those congregations are. And we work with various denominations and religious groups to get those figures. We released that last week. The most difficult one is to try to count all the independent non-denominational churches. And that's a task that I tried to do in 2010 and again now in 2020.
I know you have done some research on megachurches.
Yes.
And of course, I'm very interested in that. I've written about it. I pastor a micro church of about 25 or 30 people, a new experience for me. But let's talk about these unaffiliated churches. Who is in this category? Who qualifies?
Well, basically, any church that isn't part of a denomination or a faith group. It is somewhat challenging to know exactly whether a congregation is independent. Oftentimes, what we intentionally do is use lists of congregations that we know are non-denominational. I've been collecting those lists for a couple of decades, but then we also look up on the internet each individual congregation to see if they have any affiliation or even hidden sort of affiliation with a denomination. It doesn't matter what their size is or theological persuasion. So we have a small percentage of congregations that are progressive, that call themselves liberal. We have, you know, Pentecostal, fundamentalist, evangelicals. All along the spectrum of Protestant Christianity. So they could be mega churches or they could be micro churches,
yeah,
for sure.
I want to ask you in particular about the Christian churches, the independent Christian churches and the Churches of Christ, because when you talk to these people, they say, we're not affiliated, we're independent.
Right.
But is that, for your research, is that so?
Yeah, they're the bane of my existence. No, I mean it is challenging because in some sense, if you ask directly, they say we're non-denominational, and then you find out later that in fact they have some denominational affiliation. That's right. You know, or take a famous example, Saddleback, right? A Saddleback Church would say, "Oh, well, we're non-denominational," and then lo and behold, they're Southern Baptist. Yeah. You know, so it is, even though the list that I put together, I feel fairly confident in. I certainly don't think it's 100% accurate by any means, and we probably also have some Black Baptist congregations that say, you know, we're independent, but in fact they belong to the National Baptist or some other group. It is the best list that exists, and because this group is growing all the time, I felt like it was important to spend more than a year with a team of seven people to try to find all of these congregations.
Before we talk about the growth of it, which I'm very interested in, I want to raise another issue of who qualifies. Yeah. I contacted a pastor friend of mine in Texas who pastors what he calls a non-denominational independent church. But when I asked him how they were connected for other purposes, like to do mission work, to do ministry work, to do benevolence work, he named a whole series of networks.
Yeah.
They're not all clumped into a denomination, but that church was certainly connected to networks of churches. How do you categorize these people for your study?
Things have gotten more challenging because there are a lot of these loose networks of congregations, sometimes focused on particular topics like missions or church planting or whatever, but they don't function quite the same as a traditional denomination. And you know, oftentimes they're not exclusive. A church can belong to one network and then shift and belong to another, or belong to multiple networks at the same time. The Willow Creek Association is a good example. Denominational, non-denominational, all sorts of churches belonged to that for as long as they wanted to. You know, so it's almost a relational affiliation rather than a legal authority kind of affiliation that denominations have often had with churches. Denominations are changing. Many of them are starting to shift to a more network model. I gave a talk last week on this subject, and I talked about the kind of muddy world. You know, it's kind of ill-defined at this moment because we're in the midst of transition in many ways.
Yes, my little church is affiliated with the Cooperative Baptist Fellowship, which calls itself a network and not a denomination. But most of the people who run it are coming out of denominational work, so it really is a murky distinction. But
that's
the
right.
Big news that you wrote about last week was the growth of this segment of the Protestant population. Talk to us about those numbers.
That's right. Compared to what we found in 2010, there are about 9,000 more non-denominational churches than there were last decade. And that's about 2 million more attenders than we found before. That totals to be about 13% of all the congregations in the country. Somewhere in the neighborhood of 44,000. There are about 350,000 congregations overall, but it's a pretty significant size, and about 10% of all the people who go to churches are going to be in the non-denominational churches. So as you said, if they were a group, they would be the second largest in the country next to the Catholics.
But they're determined not to be a group, aren't they?
That's exactly right. Well, you know, it's an interesting dynamic because in some sense, once you start looking at all of the non-denominational churches, they do have a general sense of an identity, but it's not a claimed identity by every single church, but they have similar characteristics and those kinds of things.
So these churches are filling up with people who used to be in a denominational church, right?
For the most part, yes. But also, they present a different kind of Christianity in some ways, and therefore they also are attracting some of the nuns, you know, some people who are now, or at least currently, unchurched.
Well, so in what sense would it be what you call a different kind of Christianity? How would you describe that?
Yeah, for the most part, I think they would describe themselves in kind of a large evangelical camp of sorts. But that's, you know, not entirely true. As I said, about 2% would claim to be liberal. Another 3% would claim to be a progressive Christian. But when you look at one of the things that we did, we did this big census, but then I also did a survey to a sample of those congregations. And when you look at the data that comes back, it's very clear. They look predominantly like evangelical churches, mm-hmm. except they have some differences. They are more youthful, mm-hmm. right? Their population is younger. They are much more diverse racially, economically, so they have a lot more variety within the church. They have a greater percent of them are doing contemporary worship. And if you look at some of their religious practices of the individuals and the church as a whole, they're actually more fervent than the scores that you get from other evangelical churches in our sample. And they also have more effective member engagement, in part because they have to shape the individual members around the identity of that church. They can't assume that they're all going to come in with a Baptist heritage and know what to expect. They have to be trained and schooled and discipled in what our church stands for. And so they actually do a better job in some ways of holding on to their people.
You have mentioned a couple of things that I want to follow up on. You mentioned that some of these churches, a minority, are what we would call liberal or progressive churches. Yeah. When I first read your articles, I assumed that they were all in the evangelical camp. But this happened just this morning. I posted on Facebook the question, who out there is either a member of or a leader of a non-denominational church? And of course, I've got a range of responses, but one of them was from a former student of mine who started a non-denominational church 20 years ago in Cary, North Carolina, which is over in the Raleigh area. Yeah. I went on their website and looked at it and was surprised to find, and this goes to your point, that this was an open and affirming church as regards to LGBTQ. Which generally you don't find in independent, am I not right about this?
That's correct, yeah.
I was so surprised because in every other respect, the way the website looked, the way their doctrines read, the kind of staff they had, it looked like a traditional evangelical church, except for that. And I thought, well, this is a young church. That's what it means.
We also have a congregation here in Hartford, Connecticut, didn't really fully agree with American Baptist mm-hmm. Faith. They didn't fully agree with the kind of general non-denominational evangelical. And what they tried to create was an amalgam of somewhere in the middle of basically theologically conservative, but socially liberal, and you know it doesn't quite look like what you would expect necessarily.
That's exactly what I thought.
Yes.
Now I want to ask you about something else, and that is the role of branding in religion. For almost a decade, I was the pastor of a Southern Baptist church in Pittsburgh, and of course, what happened? People would move into town. They wanted to go to their brand of church. And they would drive a long way to get to their brand. These independent churches, as you said a minute ago, don't have the luxury of having a brand, so to speak. They have to brand themselves and then sell the people on their brand. Isn't that true?
Yes, it is. I mean, and I think there's some interesting dynamics going on. In some sense, I think over the last 30 years, we've seen the religious brands that are out there, you know, the various denominations, those brands have become antiquated, or the images around those brands, the cultural ideas that are associated with Southern Baptist or with Episcopalian or with Assemblies of God, have as much negative baggage as they do a positive good. Mm-hmm. And so you see not only congregations forming that say, we don't want any of those choices, but you also see congregations within some of those denominations saying, yeah, we don't want that baggage anymore. We want to create an identity for our congregation. I mean, it's almost hyper-congregationalism, right?
It is.
We want to create an identity that matches us and who we think we are as a group, not who somebody in the denominational headquarters says we should be. And I think I often talk about it as, you know, we know that individualism in the United States has grown. I talk about non-denominationalism as organizational individualism, mm-hmm. right? It's individualism at the congregational level. We want what's best for us as a community here, and that includes, you know, making sense of our identity, our brand, that sort of thing.
Yes, we've been watching this de-branding for a long time now. I remember, as you do, no doubt, when the Baptist Sunday School Board became Lifeway.
Yeah.
They wanted to take the brand out of it and create a new brand. And of course, many churches on all the denominations have dropped their branding name, whether it's Methodist or Presbyterian Baptist, and they've gone to more generic names like the River and the Point and Grace Church and things like that. Where they're trying to get away from the brand, as you say.
That's right.
Now, I want to ask you, is this part of a larger cultural dumping of brand identity?
Well, I mean, as I tied it into individualism, I think There is part of that, you know. In some ways, it's a sort of general secularization of our society, and so the nuns are an example of that too. But I do think as you begin to embody a kind of individualism, you want to craft whether it's your own personal identity. And who you associate with, or as a congregation, and so you see it play out across our society and in our culture for sure.
Well, let me ask you about, let's move out of the Protestant world for just a minute and think about the Catholic world or other religions. Are they experiencing something similar?
I mean, certainly there are defections, you know, people who leave the faith, but it's a little different in some sense between the Protestants and other religious traditions and other Christians, because in many cases those are more either or. There aren't multiple possibilities within the Catholic world for the most part, or the Muslim faith. Jewish, you could potentially move from, you know, conservative to reform, but it's not quite the same as the Protestant world, or mm-hmm. for that matter, the disestablishment of religion in the United States has always meant that Protestantism is a much more competitive reality, mm-hmm. rather than the Catholic Church that saw itself as a kind of monopoly. Mm-hmm. It was the church, and or, you know, you have to be born into Judaism, or, you know, and so in some sense it's a little bit different dynamic. Protestant is more synchronous, I think, in some ways with the consumerism and yeah. capitalism of the United States.
There's no question that's true. It is also true that there are a lot of Catholics in our country who don't like their brand.
Yeah.
And as a matter of fact, in a conversation this morning with the pastor of a large non-denominational church, I asked him, where have your members come from? It's a very interesting thing. I know you've done research on this. He said the two biggest feeder systems into our non-denominational church are Baptist and Catholics. Does that surprise you?
It doesn't surprise me at all, because in fact those are the two biggest religious groups in the country, right?
So it would be natural for them to be the biggest suppliers of members.
Yes, that's right. But I think it is true that almost any congregation, even denominational churches, if they actually ask their people, they would find they have a lot of former Catholics, or for that matter, former Southern Baptists or other Baptists. We are living in a very interesting time, I think, because there's a significant amount of switching between congregations and between faith traditions. I mean, it's not uncommon to find someone who has belonged to 6, 7, up to 10 different denominational traditions and churches in their religious career. Like my grandmother who stayed at the same church her entire life. Although it was an independent Baptist, so she was ahead of the trend.
Now, I want to ask you this. Have you done any research on TikTok?
No, I try to stay away from TikTok.
Okay, well, this feeds into our conversation because on TikTok, there are large streams of videos. You know, TikTok is where people are telling their stories. Yeah. There are just thousands of videos of people describing their exit journey out of their religion, out of Christianity, a lot of them, especially evangelical Christianity, and then a lot of them out of the Church of Jesus Christ of Latter-day Saints, we used to call Mormons. Lots of people talking about why they are leaving. You should check into it. You could write an article about that. It'd be good research.
yes, indeed.
Now, I asked my pastor friend this morning out in Texas, I said, what problems are largely unique to the independent church? I know what he said. What would you say to this?
Well, I think the foremost one that comes to my mind, I mean, there are a couple, but it is predominantly who is overseeing these congregations, right? Mm-hmm. Who provides some level of accountability? And that doesn't matter whether the church is small or large. At least the denominational framework and hierarchy would allow for a general overseer or a conference minister or state representative who would have some sense of authority of what's going on there, either theologically or, you know, in terms of behavior of the church or the pastor. I think that's the biggest challenge. I mean, it's in some ways their greatest strength, because you want a kind of entrepreneurial, innovative, let's stay current with where the world is at, but you also have to have some boundaries there. And if the church or the congregation is its own authority, then it's quite easy sometimes to get off track. And that seems to me to be the biggest challenge.
And that has really come into play on the issue of sexual misbehavior.
Yeah.
Sexual abuse in a church where church authorities, there's nobody there to hold them accountable, church pastors, church ministers. And of course, this issue of ascending liability, of for instance, that Southern Baptists are going through right now, and the Catholic Church, of being responsible as a group to what's happening at the congregational level is one of the things that congregations are trying to get away from. So that whole thing of liability works both ways. My friend in Texas, he said the two biggest issues he sees, number one, are how many of these churches depend upon the charismatic power and influence of their leader. And then he brought up the issue of succession. If you're not connected to a denomination or a seminary or something, where do you turn when you go, when you need a new pastor or even an associate pastor?
Yeah, I find both of those more challenging the larger the church gets. Mm-hmm. As I mentioned, I grew up in an independent Baptist church. That church is over 100 years old. They've had multiple clergy, right? One the sort of founding pastor was there for 50 years, but they've gone on more than 50 years since then. So, I mean, in some cases, I think the church itself, the healthier it is, the more both the board of the church and the people of the church and the clergy person really are responsible for holding the church together. But as the church gets larger and larger, that gets to be more of a challenge. You know, so it remains to be seen. But also in terms of succession, one of the things that we haven't talked about yet around these ideas of networks, part of the reason why a congregation can be non-denominational and independent is because there are a whole host of sort of parachurch organizations mm-hmm. that arose about the same time mm-hmm. as the non-denominational movement got started.
Exactly.
That don't just feed a particular denomination, right? Before, the denomination would have its own publishers and its own mission program and its own literature and all that sort of, including hymnals. And then as more and more independent churches came about, there were more organizations that said, well, we're not going to cater to just one denomination. We want it to be multi-denominational or non-denominational. And so because of that, you also have organizations that have arisen that are kind of clearing houses for clergy mm-hmm. to get
That's
jobs,
true.
Right, outside of the denominational effort. So there's this whole infrastructure yeah. to support the non-denominational reality. And so I think that's making it a little bit easier until you get to that very large size.
And that infrastructure that you're talking about looks and operates very much like a denominational structure taken together. You raised the issue of, as I did, of succession. Of course, there now are a whole group of search firms that do nothing but help churches find ministers, and that's been a new development over the last, I would say, 30 years. I don't know.
Yes.
How do you see this trend? Do you see this trend toward the non-denominational church being sustained, or where do you see this in another 10 years?
You know, I'm as you mentioned, I'm one of the few people who study this phenomena. And I started studying in the late 90s because I knew that it was growing mm-hmm. and it was going to continue. And I think it's going to continue even more so. Mm-hmm. And in fact, I've argued that there are a lot of functionally non-denominational mm-hmm. congregations within the denomination.
Yes, they are.
Right? They're sort of defecting in place.
They are.
You know, in part because the denominational identity is waning a little bit, so there's less of a tie between the individual church and the denomination. But also, because they have these other places for literature or for missions or for hymnals, a congregation in the United Methodist Church might say, well, I'm not really into the Methodist literature. I'm more interested in Cook's literature, yeah, or in, you know, Vineyard's music or something. And so they start to use those other mm-hmm. things outside of the denomination. Pretty soon, they look for all intents and purposes like a non-denominational church.
This is very prevalent in churches all over, of using mission groups, travel groups, ministry groups. I think about one of the stories I had last week, I think, was of Samaritan's Purse. Yes. A good example of a nonprofit, non-denominational organization that services churches all across the spectrum in delivering boxes and food and resources. Well, Scott, you've researched mega churches, you've researched non-denominational churches. What are you working on now?
Yes, thanks for asking. I'm really occupied these days and probably long past when my wife said I was supposed to retire. I got a very large grant to study how congregations are dealing with the impact of the pandemic. And we're about a year and a half into a five-year study. So we're trying to track what changes are taking place in both the members of churches, the clergy, and then also how congregations are organized and do their work. And so our website is covidreligionresearch.org, and we've done three national studies. We've done 100 case studies of individual churches, and we're going to continue on for the next few years. So I think I have a case of long COVID.
<That's>
I'm
great.
Going to be studying it for a long time.
And I'll bet you got your grant from the Lilly Endowment.
I did. We did. Yes.
I've worked with them for almost 20 years, so I'm very familiar with them. God bless you, Scott. Thank you for stopping by the Meeting House today and talking with us about this. Thank you for the research that you are doing. And it helps all of us who are trying to lead and serve the religious community. I'm actually going to play now a piece of music from a non-denominational church out in Dallas, Texas, the Preston Trail Community Church, whose pastor is a long-term friend of mine. And I'll be back in just a minute. Let's take a listen.
Drifting off, my heart was failing. My heart was failing. In the dark, heard a song. It was the sweetest song that I ever heard. And my soul went sailing. Yeah, my soul. I'm waking up, I can feel my heart beating and breathing.
That was the praise band at the Preston Trail Community Church in Plano, Texas, singing the song, I'm Waking Up. They're one of the non-denominational churches that now lead the whole Protestant world here in the United States. And I got that on YouTube where they put a lot of their stuff. You're in the Meeting House. I'm your host, Dr. Dwight A. Moody. With me is my friend, advisor, producer, and today my co-host, Caleb. It's great to see you today.
Thank you, Dwight. Thank you for having me here. It's good to be on the Meeting House.
Yeah. Have you attended a non-denominational church?
I have, actually. And see, this is the thing is, I grew up, I'm all across the board.
Yes.
Mother, Anglican. Father, Catholic background. They now do a Pentecostal church. And I go to a non-denominational church, and most of my siblings
go to the non-denominational church. And of course, many of the non-denominational church are Pentecostal in character.
Right.
Because the Pentecostal network, some of them are not as strong as denominationally.
Yes.
As the others.
That's exactly right. It felt very seamless, the transition from being in a Pentecostal Assemblies of God church to a non-denominational church. It felt very similar. You know, and I think that's because, you know, you're exactly right. There isn't strong ties to the specific, you know, like the
brand,
Presbyterian
brand. Really brand of religion.
Right, right.
I'm very interested in this brand idea because people get very attached to a brand like a sports brand.
Yeah, they do.
You know, they get tied to a team or a school and they stay with it all their lives. And we get tied to cars, the brand of car we like and the brand of food we want to eat.
Yeah.
But more and more when it comes to religion, we're giving up that brand and going with the preacher we like or where we like the feel of things.
Well, it was one of those topics where a lot of my friends, when they're thinking about which churches to go to, they're looking at, do they like the music? Do they like the way the pastor's dressed? But we were all thinking non-denominational church, but these are some of the conversations that we're having. And I mean, I guess you can't get too lost in that. You got to give a try to wherever you start to attend. But it's funny, these conversations that I'd have, so.
Now, you heard my reference TikTok.
Uh-huh, yes.
Now, I've played a video from YouTube, mm-hmm. But I got to talking to TikTok because I have watched a lot of these videos. You know, some people are really anti-TikTok.
Well, you're a big fan of TikTok, right?
I am, because it's the up-and-coming thing right now.
Yeah, yeah. Very, very cutting edge. I mean, literally about 1 billion users worldwide, and I think 230 million of those are in the U.S.
230 million people who regularly use TikTok.
Yes, correct. Downloaded TikTok.
And do you ever watch it?
Well, I can't get too...
You're a trendy, up-and-coming, cutting-edge kind of guy.
I appreciate that. I try my best. Things move so quickly this day and age. So, you know, what happens with me is if I begin to watch the TikTok, I could spend an hour just scrolling, you know, and I feel like that day might have not, or that hour might not have been as productive. So I try not to be as, go on as much, but I definitely, of course, you know, I know a lot of
it. It's addictive, you say.
Yeah, it is. It can be very addictive.
There goes 2 hours just like that, huh?
Yeah, I mean, honestly, and you're in a comfortable couch and you're looking at your phone, you know, anywhere you are, you could be watching the TikTok videos.
Or making a TikTok video.
Yeah.
From anywhere. I have watched these videos because I've been very interested in the TikTok videos. People are telling their stories.
They are.
And some of them are stories about breakups or falling in love or starting a business or losing a business. But there's a lot of them, as I said, where people are telling the story about why they're leaving a church, why they're leaving a denomination, why they're leaving a religion.
Right. Absolutely.
I find this fascinating.
Yeah. You know, people from all walks of life, people describing all kinds of different things. And another thing, too, is people from all age groups as well.
You've got the statistics right here.
I have a couple statistics right here. Literally about 10 to 19 years of age, there's 32.5% of TikTok downloader users are ages 10 to 19. 29.5% are ages 20 to 29. 16.4%, 30 to 39, and 40 to 49 years of age, 13.9%.
And what's that last category right
well,
there?
Well, here's something very
this
interesting.
This is my category.
Here's something very interesting. A lot of people may not realize that 50 years old and over is 7.1% of TikTok
that
users.
That is 7.1% of the TikTok viewers,
yeah.
Or even people who are making TikTok videos.
Yeah, and that's probably of the users, the 230 million U.S.-based users. So 7.1% of those are age 50 and above.
You know, I've thought about getting on TikTok.
You know what, Dwight? That would be a fantastic idea. I mean, you could do it. You could do it for the Meeting House.
What do you mean?
I mean, you could have a TikTok that actually tells the story about how you created the Meeting House, how you're creating this entire platform, this show.
Well, I thought I would just take my same material here and repackage it into 3 minutes, but you're suggesting something else.
Just telling people about, you know, I've worked with you a little bit, you know, for about 6 months or so on your show and on the concept. It seems like there's so many things you have to consider and hurdles to jump, you know, in developing your show and your platform. Show that to the audience.
What do you mean? Just talk about that on
yes.
a TikTok video?
No, absolutely. Yeah, talk about it on a TikTok video. Now, the TikTok videos, you know, they're very short, but you take them through your whole process.
So, okay, what was it? Yesterday or the day before,
yeah.
You and I met
yes.
in downtown Hendersonville.
Yes, I remember
we,
that.
We sat at a little cafe right by the window, watching everybody walk by.
Absolutely.
And we talked about my Meeting House show.
I should
do a TikTok about that.
Yeah, you did. Well, it was funny too. As people were walking by the cafe that we were at, they would look at the outside of the building and they would wonder if they would come in. And we were peering from the window.
I watched them.
And so it was funny because like that in itself could be a great TikTok.
I wanted to set up a camera right there and film the people
yeah.
who were.
Yeah.
Now I have
That's a
TikTok video I want to show.
Okay.
And I want to explain it.
All right.
Because you are
I'm excited
kind of a TikTok
to see this one.
Novice.
Oh yeah.
You
I
don't
am.
Know this. So.
I'm a novice. I will say.
Many of the TikTok videos deal with issues, pro and con on a particular issue, and many of these involve one person who's arguing both sides, and they'll dress up one way, and argue this side, and then the next part of the video is the same person dressed up another way arguing the other side, and it goes back and forth. That's the kind of video this is, and it is about religion. So I want us to play it and then we'll talk about it. It's not very long, maybe a minute or two. Let's watch.
Food and clothes to all the families there. It's called mission work. You're just helping people without expectation. That's awesome. Well, there's the expectation that they start following our religion. Oh, well, that's colonization. It's important to teach your child that we follow the right religion when they're at a very young age. That way they're more likely to follow it into adulthood. It's called good parenting. Sounds like indoctrination. Nothing will ever make me stop believing. Even if somebody shows me evidence that contradicts my religion, I'll still believe. It's called faith. The literal definition of that is cognitive dissonance. And if you ask Jesus to forgive you of your sins, you get to spend an eternity in heaven. It's called salvation. What happens if you don't say the prayer? Well, you'll spend an eternity in hell. That's not salvation, that's extortion.
Well, what did you think about that?
That was a really great video. I liked how there was, she played the two sides.
She played the both sides.
It was the same person.
Same person.
That's fantastic.
Yeah, it's very common on TikTok as they deal with these kind of religious issues.
Yeah.
And I've been thinking about it. Mm-hmm. And I have to talk with you more about whether I should jump into TikTok.
I think it would be a fantastic idea. I mean, really. I mean, can you imagine, you know, just your everyday life, the things you go through to prepare for the Meeting House, you know, and showing people that. I think that'd be very fascinating.
You think it, well, I could even make a video in the studio here.
Yeah.
I mean, I could make a video about next week's program.
That would be a great
idea. I'll tell you what
idea.
I'm thinking about on next week's program, and maybe that I should do a TikTok on this, is this movie slash television show called The Chosen. I wonder if any of my viewers have seen this. Have you watched it?
The Chosen. I don't believe I've seen that.
You can get it on television, but it's also at the movie theaters. It's about the life of Jesus.
Okay.
And it was the third ranked grossing movie this past weekend, which is means a lot of money.
Yeah, that's huge.
Caleb, thanks for coming by the meeting house today.
Oh, thank you so much for having me, Dwight.
You'll have to come back.
Absolutely.
I need your
help.
This
is fun. Yeah. No, I mean, honestly, this is really fun, and it's a beautiful set. And really, congratulations on all your work on this.
I want to thank everybody for stopping by the meeting house for our conversation on religion and American life. You know, we're interested in both the public aspects of religion, that is how religion influences public life, like the presidential campaign or public policy, but also how it influences our personal and private lives, how we engage in prayer or mission work, or how it motivates us to invest in the welfare of people in our community. All of this is part of our conversation here in the Meeting House. You can go to our website at themeetinghouse.net. You can read commentaries there and book reviews. You can watch all of these podcasts. Some of them are video. Some of them are just audio podcast. You can even make a donation to help keep us on the air. We've got plans to take the Meeting House on the road. You'll have to go with me sometime, Caleb.
I'm there.
I'll talk about that later. Thank you for joining us in the Meeting House. I'm Dwight A. Moody with Caleb Owolabi. You have a happy day. And a happy Thanksgiving to everybody.